Episode 24 of Covering the Bases, the official podcast of USA Baseball, has arrived. I'm Daron Vaught. Appreciate the download, listen, subscription. You can do so anywhere you get your podcasts, Google, Spotify, Apple, and we upload every episode to the USA Baseball YouTube channel as well. Wherever you subscribe or find this podcast, please rate and review. Would be greatly appreciated. I hope you enjoyed our last episode as much as I did. Adam Jones, who's playing in Japan, and by the way, tearing the cover off of the baseball for the Oryx Buffaloes. But for this edition of our Prospects on Deck, we have the pleasure of talking to a number one overall pick in the MLB draft. Not the first time we've ever had such an honor, but it's the first time we've gotten the number one pick fresh off of being the number one pick. Spencer Torkelson is a two-time Collegiate National Team alum. We saw him hit baseballs really far in our own backyard in Cary at the National Training Complex, as you might have seen if you attended a game at Arizona State or elsewhere in college baseball. Pretty soon, if you go to a game in Detroit, you might see him hit balls a very long way for the Detroit Tigers. He broke Barry Bonds' freshman home run record as a member of the Sun Devils. He was the Baseball America cover boy not quite a year ago. And that's right, round one, pick one, to the Detroit Tigers just a couple of weeks ago at the MLB Draft. We'll get right to it on this edition, episode 24 of Covering the Bases, Spencer Torkelson. Colin, roll the open.
From high above Coleman Field at the USA Baseball National Training Complex in Cary, North Carolina, this is Covering the Bases with Daron Vaught.
Spencer, first and foremost, big congratulations. First overall pick in the MLB draft just a couple of weeks ago as we are recording this. What were your emotions at the moment, and did you know anything beforehand? Because it looked like sincere and genuine surprise out of the at-home shot on the broadcast with you and, I assume, family and friends.
Yeah, first off, thank you, but I didn't know anything before, leading up to that. I was, you know, yeah, at home all day, haven't heard anything from pretty much any team. And then, I guess Detroit, was going to blind pick me the whole time. And I was texting. So when the commissioner went up on stage, like, introduced the 2020 MLB draft, and then he's like, and then they went to the commercial, I like blacked out. And I was texting my advisor. I'm like, what's happening, dude? Like, what's going on? And he was telling me, he said, you know, we think you're the guy, but they haven't called us the last, like, couple of days. So, like, just be ready for anything. I was like, all right. And then as soon as the commissioner got on the stage and he said, like, with the first pick of the 2020 MLB draft, he said, like, in Spencer, we just went crazy. It was so pure as a family, and some of my closest friends and teammates were there too, so. Yeah, it was a pretty special moment that I'll never forget.
It was, I mean, honestly, of all of the, you know, of course, we've seen a change in the draft shows, and the NFL was the first to do it, so you got a lot of those in-home looks. Of all of those, it seemed to me like a truly beautiful moment where you guys had no idea, and I know that's got to be so rarely the case. So it was cool to me. I noticed, and there was some fodder on social media about this, the movie posters in the background. Yeah. There was the Sandlot was there. I saw Jaws.
We got the good, bad, the ugly.
Okay.
Sandlot, Jaws, Caddyshack, Tombstone, and The Shawshank Redemption.
Okay, all great movies. What's the story with that? Just family favorites?
Honestly, a couple of them might be. I know Sandlot's one of my top five movies, and Jaws and Caddyshack are close. But it's kind of like a TV room, and my mom didn't want to blank walls, not big movie posters. It kind of went like that. Nothing crazy though.
So nothing other than they're movie posters of movies we enjoy. There's not it's not supposed to be sort of an all-time favorites for the family wall or anything like that. I mean, they're good. It looks great. So for the purposes of a movie room, it looks cool.
I'll make sure to tell my mom that. Yeah, I know. I left freshman year of college, come back, and got posters. So that's how it went.
Nice. Another element to that night, Spencer, is that you were not only chosen by the Detroit Tigers first overall, you were chosen, as it was announced, as a third baseman. So even though most of your time defensively throughout college had been spent at first base, is this something that you expected, or what do you see yourself as at the pro level?
It wasn't expected, but it's not shocking, if that makes sense. Because I like to just be a baseball player. I'm not trying to label myself as just a first baseman and limit to myself as only that. So you want to be an all-around player and helping the team win. So if they see me as a third baseman, I trust them more than anything, and I'm going to work at third base and give the team the best chance to win at third. And it doesn't make a difference to me. I know a lot of people were super surprised, but at the end of the day, you got to throw it, catch it, and hit it. So it's all the same wherever you play.
Yeah, that's a good way to look at it. How often have you played third or anywhere else in the infield as of late?
I played third pretty much my whole life. Like after shortstop days were over when I was like 14, because I got a little big. Not like fat, but
just a little bulky. I get it.
I wasn't like the typical shortstop,
Yeah.
But I moved to third, and I was there until freshman year of college, and I still took reps over there. But we had a great third baseman, Gage Workman, at ASU, and I had no problem letting him lock down the hot corner and play some first base.
Gage, who is also going to be a Detroit Tiger in the organization, yeah. Right?
Yep. He signed last week. It's really cool.
So tell me about young Spencer. You talked about the gradual move just because filling out your body, you change positions in baseball specifically. Were you interested in other sports growing up?
Oh, yeah. I played everything growing up, from soccer, football, hockey, basketball. You name it. I liked just competing and playing any sport that, whatever season it was. And if I couldn't play baseball, I was playing, hockey, because it's different seasons. It was kind of like that. So I really enjoyed playing all the different sports, having all these friends, and competing. Is, my whole goal was just to win. It didn't really matter what, size the ball was.
When did baseball become central then? Like your primary
sport? From day one.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was always day one. I liked hockey a lot, but I realized that I couldn't play like in high school because, one, I wanted to play football, and two, it's in Santa Rosa. The season's a little crazy. So I gave up hockey to play high school football, and that was a lot of fun as well. But baseball was always centered, and that was what I wanted to do my whole life.
So at what age, baseball-wise, did you think something like becoming a first-round draft pick was possible?
I would say I wanted to become a professional baseball player when I was like 8, when I realized that I was pretty good. I was like, damn, I want this to be my job. So that's when I wanted to play baseball. And then I would say, freshman year of college, I always wanted to be a first rounder, but I never being from Northern California, it doesn't get a lot of respect in, like, in, you know, prep, like high school baseball. So, I mean, probably freshman year of college, like within the first 10 games of my season, I was like, dang, I could make something out of this.
I would say breaking Barry Bonds' records might help with that, right? As far as the confidence is concerned.
Definitely.
Speaking of your what would have ended up being your junior season at Arizona State, everybody in college baseball and in college athletics, and there are people dealing with it in all facets of life, really, but you guys had an eerie, abrupt end to your season. What was it all like? What were you doing when it occurred to you, okay, my junior season might be done?
It was the weirdest, like, 2 weeks of my life, honestly. Like, we had a meeting in March, and they're like, oh, we're canceling the Utah series this week because of COVID. And we're like, damn, like, we're canceling a series for this? And then we're like, all right, it's okay. We'll keep practicing, and then we'll go on and we'll play the next week, whatever. And then, like, the next day, they canceled practice for the week as well. And then the next day, I was on Twitter, just hanging out in my apartment, and, like, D1 Baseball or someone posted, like, Big Ten has canceled their season and there's going to be no College World Series. And so then everything started, like, the wheels were turning, everything started to click. I was like, wow. If there's no College World Series and the Big Ten's not playing, there's no reason to play a season. Yeah. And then, like, I think the following day, they just canceled everything. And I did not know what to do with my life. I've never done nothing in the months, you know, March through June.
So what did you end up finding? I mean, obviously, you had certain responsibilities, right? You wanted to stay in shape and stay sharp from a baseball perspective as a draft hopeful anyway. How did all of that work? Did you suddenly lose access to certain things that you normally would have had and had to find some workarounds?
Yeah. So the first 2 weeks after the news broke out, I was kind of like, I don't even know. I was in shock. So I just golfed every day with my brother down there. and then that passed. Golf started to get really old and I was getting too good. And I was like, you know, I should be good at golf right now. So I got back, quickly got back in the batting cage, but I knew I had a lot of time to be ready. So the facilities were closed. They closed down the Arizona State ones pretty early, just because it's such a big university. So the batting cage was closed there, and the weight room was as well. So I'm like, well, I don't have a place to work out in Arizona. So I packed my stuff up, drove back home to Petaluma, where one of my best friends luckily has a weight room in his garage that I abused. And then my mom bought me a batting cage for my backyard. So I made it work.
Nice. Okay.
Yeah. We made it work.
Well, good to hear. I mean, obviously, it just sort of threw a wrench in the gears. Like, you have friends and teammates that you normally would see every day and hang out with and go on road trips with that, you know, everything kind of came to this halting stop. What was your communication like with teammates? A guy like, you know, an Alika Williams, who's also a Collegiate National Team alum, guys like that, who you didn't expect not to see them throughout the months of March, April, May, and June. I guess the theoretically, as we're recording this, it is June 24th. I think it was just a couple of nights ago that a deciding game in the College World Series would have happened, or could have been the case if it played out to as many games as it as was as were possible. But it's just kind of wild to think that you don't have those ongoing connections for that stretch of the year.
Yeah, you're right. That is super weird. You know, I never expected to miss a Liga, you know? I was always with them. We were always traveling together, and never expected to miss Gage Workman because he's always my roommate on the road, and my buddy Brady. Just like all my teammates, you know, you practice with them every day. Sometimes practice gets long, but when the season's canceled and you don't have practice, you just miss those times you had with your teammates, playing a game, you know, at a great university. But yeah, I didn't really, I thought that was really weird. I didn't want to miss Alika and Gage and Brady in June, but here we are.
Yeah, no, here we are.
We text and we have like a team Snapchat, so everyone fills us, each other in on what everyone's doing. So it's not terrible, but
nice.
Rather be with each other playing baseball.
Yeah. Amen. Amen to that. Just in time for summer and the 4th, there are 4 all new era 5950 caps to celebrate Independence Day at USABaseballShop.com. That includes the flag front 5950, the white flag front 5950, and 2 more great designs. Shop those items and much more, free ground shipping on all orders of $75 or more at USABaseballShop.com. Since this is the USA Baseball Podcast, let's get to your collegiate national team experience. It started your freshman year, and you got a call from Paul Maneri that invited you to participate with the collegiate national team after your freshman year, which was a good one at Arizona State. What was it like getting that initial call?
Yeah, that initial call was unreal because I got cut from the 15U national team when I was like 14, almost 15. Yeah, in like 2014, I went to the trials, made the trials roster, then I was cut because I didn't play that well, I'll be honest. And then I got the call from Coach Maneri when I was on my way to study hall at ASU. Hey, this is Coach Maneri. And I thought I saw something like a couple weeks before that he was announced the head coach of the college national team. So like, I put two and two together. I'm like, whoa. this is going to be good.
So before he even got the question out, you had kind of assumed what it was going to be.
Yeah, I figured what the conversation would be about.
Yeah,
not that he invited me to be on the team exactly, but something along those lines.
Yeah,
and I got the call from him, and I was like, "Yes, I want to play." Yes.
Was that something that was on your radar as a freshman at ASU, or no? Were you just kind of tunnel vision, taking it plate appearance by plate appearance?
Yeah, I had no idea about the collegiate national team until I was like 11 home runs deep, and my head coach was like, "Hey, you might be able to play on the national team." I was like, "What? No way!" And then, I mean, I kind of tuned it out because we were just trying to win college games at that point, and then whatever happens after that happens. But yeah, I wasn't familiar with the collegiate national team going into the season. It wasn't a goal because I didn't know anything about it. You know, I thought you just go play summer ball, know, Alaska or the Cape Cod League or Northwoods. I thought that was it, but it opened up a whole new door, and it was, you know, the 2 best summer experiences of my life.
So walk me through first summer. I believe you and Daniel Cabrera, as far as position players are concerned, were the only 2 freshmen on that first team, the first collegiate national team. So that would have been summer of 2018. And Cabrera didn't even come until a little bit later.
His teammate, Duplantis, Antoine, yeah, he was on the team, and he got banged up a little bit. And then Daniel was an alternative, and he came and just absolutely balled out. It was fun to see.
Yeah, so with that roster, guys, some of whom you had played against during your first collegiate season. Others are ACC, SEC guys, all conference guys, right? I mean, it's just a stacked team. What was it like reporting to the National Training Complex in Cary for the first time and sort of just being dropped into this group of other great players?
It was intimidating. I'd be lying if I told you it wasn't. You know, I'm a freshman. My name is just now being known in baseball, and I'm teammates with, you know, Andrew Vaughn, Adley Rutschman, Bryson Stott, Braden Shoemake, you know, Shea Langeliers, like all these, so many more, Josh Young. There's like all these absolute studs in, you know, with great track records in college baseball that I'm teammates with. And it took me a couple days to be like, all right, these guys are normal too. Like, I'm a normal dude. These guys are cool. And, you know, they're just super talented at baseball. It's nothing to deal.
Was there a specific moment, Spencer, where you were like, okay, I belong here. I deserve to be here. Like, based on a play that you made or a hit that you got.
I hit a home run in trials and I was like, okay, they're doing the same thing. I can do the same thing as them. Let's do this thing. It's like, you know, let your feet touch the ground a little bit.
Yeah. So the international travel component that summer included a trip to Cuba. Had you ever been out of the country much prior to that point? I mean, at that point, you're 18, maybe 19 years old. What kind of international travel had you done up until then?
I've been out of the country because my mom's brother, my uncle, played professional soccer in Germany. Now he coaches there. So I've been to Germany a couple times and then made little stops on the way. From what I remember, I was pretty young. I was like probably 8 or 10, around those. But Cuba was different, and it was such a cool experience, you know, to play baseball in a foreign country. A foreign country that not a lot of people go to, and then share it with all these teammates that are, like I said, studs. And it gave you a new perspective because you're playing you're playing the same game, but they play it a little differently. You know, it gives you a whole new, you know, paradigm of baseball. So which is really unique.
Yeah, that actually reminds me of something I wanted to bring up from your second summer with the Collegiate National Team. So just not even quite a year ago. It was the 4th of July game at Durham Bulls Athletic Park. You guys were facing Cuba. You, if I'm not mistaken, had a pretty good day at the plate too that day. You were like 2 for 4, maybe an RBI double, something like that. And
I hope you're right. Yeah,
yeah. Take my word for it. That's fine. but it was against Cuba, and we had a moment up in the press box because I was doing play-by-play for that one. And there was a moment where I cannot remember for the life of me who was on the mound, but I even remember the Cuban base runner. It was their first baseman, Yordanis Simone, and he was, if you remember, not like a chubby guy, but he was just a little bit stockier in stature because most of those guys are pretty young. So especially in the outfield and in the infield, they have kind of wiry frames. But he batted barehanded and was a pretty stocky guy. Well, he was at first base and you were holding him on the bag. And again, I cannot remember the pitcher, but you guys get into this little cat and mouse game throwing over at Simone. And it just becomes obvious. He doesn't speak English. I don't think you speak fluent Spanish, Spencer. No. So it was this funny moment where you guys were just like nodding back and forth. You made eye contact and were laughing about the situation. And it occurred to us up in the broadcast booth how cool that is, right? I mean, everyone understands, no matter if you know baseball, no matter what language you speak, you understood what was happening there. And it was this cool moment where, you know, we've got a team that's mainly Spanish speakers, a team that's mainly English speakers, yet there's this universal language playing out on the field. It's a cool thing to see. So given that moment, I think you're the perfect person to just talk about the differences in culture as they pertain to the same sport. Do you happen to remember anything? I mean, it was a tiny moment in, you know, the thousands of baseball games that you've played at this point in your life. But it was just, it was funny because it involved three or four consecutive throws over. Maybe it was Andrew Abbott on the mound. Just spitballing on the pitcher, but it was you and Simone at first for sure.
Yeah, I definitely remember that. And after like the second time, if I remember correctly, Simone was like a little lazy guy. You know, he's just was there to hit homers and, you know, catch some balls at first. He wasn't the fastest guy. And we picked over once, and he's like, you could tell he's like, I'm not stealing. Like, he wasn't saying that. I mean, he's like, I'm not stealing. What are you doing? And then me and whoever the pitcher was, I like messing with base runners just because, you know, you have to have some fun. And I was like, I kept giving the picks on him, like, hey, just keep throwing over. Like, let's tick him off a little bit. And then, he threw over a couple more times. And finally, he got the joke and he started laughing about it. He took like a foot lead next time. I was like, all right, there's no reason to throw over. Just go to the plate now. But yeah, I do remember that. He was angry at me for a little bit and then he lightened up.
That's fantastic, cool. Man. Because it can't be often that as somebody who played a lot of first base in recent years, it can't be that often where the guy taking their lead off of first doesn't speak the same language as you. So it was, that's the perfect opportunity to use the game to play a joke and that sort of thing. I mean, other than this international play that you've experienced with the collegiate national team, I don't know. That's probably never happened to you, right?
No. Yeah. That's definitely the only time it's ever happened. Probably did the same thing in Japan as well, but that's the only time I've ever played against, you know, someone who doesn't speak the same language as me is with USA Baseball.
That's cool. I'm glad you remembered it because it was something that it was, again, a small snapshot of a moment, but it resonated with us at the time.
Yeah.
In what is normally a really cool environment anyway, the 4th of July game, whether it's in Durham or Charlotte, it's always, always a lot of fun.
That's my favorite game of the year for sure.
And the next year, you guys that was your second season. So that event was last summer, but that was with Cuba playing in the States. And you guys went to Japan that summer as part of the international travel component. Do me a favor and just compare. Just baseball in the United States versus baseball in Cuba versus baseball in Japan, based on what you saw.
It's so hard to compare them because they're the same but totally different. You go over to Japan and these guys are, you know, they take like 500 dry hacks a day and then like 300 swings off the tee, and then it's like, it's a routine. Like, everything's just like, it's like boot camp almost. And then, it's so professional and organized. And then you go to Cuba and they're just hanging out, you know, kind of look like they just woke up, walking out to BP, and then they still rake, you know. it's like totally different worlds. And then in the United States, everyone has their own routine. Some guys are more relaxed, some guys are more, you know, organized and, you know, focused. It looks like everyone's focused, but some guys look like they're, you know, a little more focused than others. And so everyone's a little different. But in Cuba, they're all the same, you know, laid back. And then Japan, everyone's uptight, doing the same thing, same mechanic almost. It's really cool because, you know, you can learn so much from playing all these, you know, different cultures.
Speaking of learning, I would imagine there was a different approach from your perspective between year number one in year number two with the Collegiate National Team. What were some of the differences when you reported to Carey the second time around last summer?
I think the biggest difference was being on the team the year before. I was able to help out. I knew what was going on, and I was able to help out guys that were first year guys, and kind of show them the ropes. You know, not use the leadership role to my advantage, but just to use it as a benefit to the team. Of, you know, here, like, this is how you do it. When you do something wrong, I'm gonna let you know. But you know, we're all here to have a good time and, you know, win some games against international competition. So it was pretty neat my last year here, or my last year there. Just being able, like, being there before and being able to show guys what's gonna go on, what's gonna happen.
What was the camaraderie like? We talked about both of the trips to Cuba and Japan, the off the field stuff. What stands out from each of those trips?
Yeah, it's super neat because, you know, you're only with these guys for what, like 4 weeks, five weeks maybe. And then by the end of the summer, you know, you're best friends with a couple of them and you're talking to them every day once you leave. Like last summer, I was buddies with Heston and like Casey Martin, and I never thought I'd, you know, good buddies with them. You know, they're in the SEC. They're Heston's from Texas, Casey's from Arkansas. Like, never in a million years would I have thought I'd be buddies with them, but here we are. You know, a year later, and I'm talking to them, you know, on the phone or Snapchatting them. It's neat.
So what were your favorite things that you guys did? I, you know, there's not a ton of time to do a lot of touristy things or a lot of exploring in either of those countries, but you do have some downtime when you're in Cuba, in Japan with the Collegiate National Team. Anything in particular just that was funny or especially fun?
Yeah, so in Cuba, right across the street from our hotel is like this restaurant, and it was so good. They had the best chicken tacos, and everyone on the team would go there every day, you know, for lunch or for dinner, whatever time our game was, and get like 6 chicken tacos each, and we sold them out. Like, we were in Cuba for like 10 days or a week. I don't know for sure. But the following week, they were out of chicken tacos. Like, the chicken to make the tacos with, they're like, we're all out. You guys sold us out. which is pretty funny. That was probably my favorite story in Cuba. And then, Japan, it was, we took the bus into Tokyo, I want to believe. And then we went to this like sumo wrestler restaurant, like where they actually do sumo wrestling, and we ate what sumo wrestlers like 5 times a day. And that was super neat because it's a lot of food. There's no secret why they're so fat.
Right. That's got to be an experience. So it was like was it dinner and a show? Were there sumo wrestling bouts going on?
No, I wish. That'd be pretty cool. we saw one of their like mats, you know, their stadium, like a, you know, wherever they wrestle. We saw one of those, and you could tell like this place is legit. Like, this is so real. Like, we were eating. It was like this big soup, like a big thing of hot water that they just poured fish and noodles and, I mean, whatever else, lettuce, whatever in there that they could eat. Like, they just poured it into this hot bowl of water and ate it. I'll be honest, it wasn't that great, but the experience was something I won't forget.
That's incredible, man. Good stuff. Appreciate you sharing that. So we talked about Daniel Cabrera of LSU, also being on the collegiate national team as a freshman like you were. He was also drafted by the Tigers. Have yep. you been in touch with him since? I mean, assumedly, you guys are going to play at least close to the same trajectory on your way up to the bigs.
Yeah, that was really cool to see. I was watching the draft the second day just to see who my future teammates are. And it was really cool to see Gage and Daniel. And I reached out to all the guys that got drafted, saying, like, you know, let's go. it was cool because now you're teammates. You know, we're going to be best friends. Like, whether you like it or not, we got to be tight. So, yeah, that was really cool seeing Daniel because I played with him my freshman summer, and he was such a good dude and obviously really good at baseball.
Yeah, you mentioned reaching out to other draft picks. I would imagine being taken first overall, you heard from a lot of people, many family and friends, I'm sure. Was there anybody in particular that you got a text from that, or a call from that surprised you?
Yeah, I got a DM on Instagram from Pete Alonso, and that was really special. Is because he's. You know, he was rookie of the year last year.
Yeah.
He had such a good year. And, yeah, it was cool because, you know, I've seen, you know, comps, like people comp me to him. And I'll take that because he's a dude. And, you know, for him to reach out to me, he's like, you know, it's only just begun. Congrats. But, you know, we're not there yet. So that was awesome.
That's an interesting one to me. Mainly because you mentioned the comparisons that you get to him. But if I'm not mistaken, he dropped pretty far in the
draft.
He was
a second rounder. Yeah.
So I mean, relatively speaking, not a late pick. But there was, especially with guys like, I know you know Andrew Vaughn well, there's been some hesitation in the past for taking somebody who fits your guy's profile, defensively especially. So high in the draft, and Andrew, at least, you know, in the past 5 to 10 years, sort of broke that mold, and you obviously are doing the same, being taken first overall. But I don't have a question, Spencer, but that's just interesting since you mentioned Pete Alonso, and I don't expect you to dive into draft strategies of MLB front offices because certainly you believe you're a worthy number one pick, and I'm not going to get in the way of that, but. I'll use that as a segue to talk about Vaughn because you guys are both 707, Sonoma County guys. You guys have both worked with Joey Gomes, right, for an extended mm-hmm. period of time. Well, tell me about, and I asked Andrew the same question when he was on with me, this very podcast. Tell me about Party Out Front, that mantra.
Yeah, Party Out Front. It sticks, doesn't it?
Yeah, it's good. I like it.
Yeah, I mean, Party Out Front, it's talking about obviously hitting a home run and out front because, oh my gosh, we're freaking dogs. All right, here we are. But yeah, Party Out Front. Sorry about that.
No, you're good.
I was hearing Party Out Front when I was like 14 years old. And it didn't really click with me until I was like 18 years old in college. But it finally did. And Joey Gomes really talks about is balance, rhythm, and timing. And those are like the three keys to hitting. And the timing part is, you know, partying out front. Because you can't hit a home run, you know, not partying, like hitting the ball deep, you know, unless it's opposite field, obviously. But most of the home runs are, you're hitting it out front. You're not getting tans. It's out front. So Joey came up with this thing, Party Out Front. It's totally stuck, and it didn't click with me for a couple of years, but thank God it did.
It's actually kind of brilliant coaching on his part in the sense that it's not a novel concept, right? You want to get out in front and hit the ball mm-hmm. as it's in front of you. But he makes it sound so cool. At 14 yeah. years old, I got to imagine Little Tork desperately wants to be a part of this Party Out Front movement just because it 100%. Sounds so fun.
Yeah, 100%. I thought that was cool.
Well, talk to me about Vaughn. How deep does that friendship, that relationship go with Andrew?
Yeah, I've always played against Andrew. My first time playing with him or against him, I remember he was 12, I was 11 in Little League, and it was like the tournament champion. So different Little Leagues, the best team in each Little League plays each other for the TOC championship. And he was on the Mark West team, if I'm remembering correctly, and I was on Pelham Valley. And I remember driving to the game with my uncle and my dad. They're like, hey, I think I might have been pitching that day. He's like, hey, there's three hitter, you know, stay away from him. You know, he's really good. You leave it over the plate, probably hit a home run. And so I remember that. I didn't know his name or anything, but looking back at it, that was Vaughn. And it was pretty cool because then I played against him every year in high school. He went to a high school in the same league as mine. He was always the best player on the field, you know, noticeably. And yeah, I hit with him a couple times during this pandemic, and I think I might be hitting with him today if he's going to be there. But yeah, he's a great dude, and to see him go through what he went through last year about, you know, going through the role and kind of learning from him, he'd give me advice, you know, just worry, control what you can control. Everything's going to be fine, you know, just trust in that. Was really nice to have. And so he's kind of like a big brother almost, but I'm taller. So
yeah, you're bigger. You're a little bit.
I have to give him some.
Well, you'll have to give him our best. So what's next for you? I know we, as we're recording this, have tentative plans in place for a Major League Baseball season. Have you gotten any kind of direction from the Tigers as far as what your next steps are going to be?
Yeah, so I'm staying ready. I haven't gotten any official word of anything yet. Still waiting to sign. That's going to happen rather soon, I believe. But nothing crazy for me. Just staying ready and working out, and you know, hoping I do play baseball this year, because that'd be pretty fun.
You missed out on a lot of it in the spring that, you know, I feel like we all missed out. We were looking forward to seeing the season come to completion with Arizona State and you guys hopefully being there in Omaha, and our guy Spencer Torkelson hopefully being a Golden Spikes finalist at that point. We had a lot of high hopes, and I guess we're all dealing with it in our own ways, because the pandemic has taken certain things from certain people, but a good lift for sure to be taken number one overall. I'm positive of it. So, Spencer, thanks for the time, man. We're super proud to have you as a part of the USA Baseball family. Continued success. Best of luck as you go forward, whatever that means for this season with the Tigers. But we know you'll stay ready and be ready when your moment comes.
Oh, beautiful. Thank you guys so much.
Well, that does it for episode 24 of Covering the Bases. Hope you enjoyed the number one overall pick, Spencer Torkelson. Just one thing to highlight there, that's now two consecutive episodes with he and Adam Jones mentioning that they did not make a Team USA roster at a lower level before being wherever they were. In Spencer's case, it was with the Collegiate National Team. In AJ's case, it was with the World Baseball Classic squad, not until he was a pro. So it's really cool to hear stories of persistence from guys who are truly among the greats within the sport. Stay ready in a couple of weeks. Our next episode, now an assistant coach at the University of Texas, longtime Colorado Rockies great, also spent some time with the Blue Jays and then the Yankees at the end of his big league career. Another Collegiate National Team alum, Troy Tulowitzki, Tulo, our next guest on Covering the Bases, the official podcast of USA Baseball, which you can find anywhere you get your podcasts, Apple, Google, Spotify, and we post every episode to the USA Baseball YouTube channel as well. Until then, I'm Daron Vaught. Stay safe, and we'll catch you later.